I then returned to my bed, and the alarm clock went off, but I didn't hear it. "Ralph, wake up!" Emily shook my shoulder. "You were sleeping like the dead." "Well, it's no wonder. I was hanging around with them all night," I answered sleepily. "What did you say?" "I didn't quite understand what you..." I cut her off. "Em, from today on, you will have nothing to worry about. I will make everything all right for you and the kids. There will be no more worries. We will have a great holiday." Ralph got dressed and drove to the office downtown in record time. He shocked his two remaining employees when he barged into the lobby. He instructed Bubba to put some coffee on because he was going to be locked in the office and on the phone for a long time. He was energized. He told him to also be available around the clock because Bubba was going to be checking out the deals that Ralph would provide. He would need pictures, competitive recent market prices, comps, marketability studies. Next, he had Simone get on the MacBook Air laptop and gather together a list of 100 leads derived from the internet. They used every popular resource that was available, the MLS, Craigslist, Zillow, Trulia, Redfin, even eBay, anywhere there were homes for sale and for rent. He was going to make a deal happen today by sheer force of will. He had a shiver just thinking about what could happen. Was the ghost of lease purchase future right? Could he change his destiny? He had to try. He had to become Mr. Lease Purchase again, just like the old days. Simone began by selecting every home for rent and sale in a specific zip code where she knew sales were slow. If the boss had this new energy and was going to save the company, then she and Bubba would support him in any way they could. She knocked on his private office door and gave him the prospect list she had developed. "Hey, boss, here's the list you asked for." "Great, Simone. I want you to do the same thing for every zip code in the Seattle area. I want 100 leads with phone calls every day. I will do the rest." "That's fine, boss, but we do have a problem. The rent is due and we need at least $5,000 to bring it up to date. There is also the matter of our salaries. To be honest, Ralph, I don't think Big Bubba and I can hang on much longer. We have families and bills to pay too." "You're right, Simone, and I apologize. I let everyone down. Give me a second chance, just 1 week, and I promise to turn things around. Call the landlord and see if you can stall that eviction for just a few more days. Can you do that for me?" "Sure. It's almost Christmas, right?" Wow, this sounded like the old boss she once knew. "Great. Tell Bubba what I said, too. Now keep the leads and the coffee coming. I have deals to do. Oh, yes, before I forget, we need to get some online marketing and social networking going. We need to build a list of new tenant buyers, a qualified list. Can you handle that? Give a call to the local real estate clubs and see if we can do an ad, or better yet, have them do an email blast for us. Is our investor list still active? Call everyone and make sure they are ready to do deals." Ralph began making calls from the list. He preferred to do rentals first and then the for sale by owners, using the gut sales method. He was very direct, honest, and assertive without being a bully, and he made no presentations unless he was closing the deal after specific qualifications and a commitment. He really embraced Max's three-minute rule on closing. The first 25 calls were voicemails. He left a personal message on each one, which sounded like this. "Hi, this is Ralph Smith, and I have your number in front of me. I need you to call me back in the next 60 minutes. It's very important. My number is 970-726-7979. He reached a few people in the next 25 calls and had a few callbacks. With each one, he would open his iPad Air and use the Google Earth application so he could get an idea of what the home and the neighborhood look like. "Hi, Mrs. Prospect. Your home must be sold or rented by now, right?" he asked. Prospect: "No, it's still available." "Ralph, mind if I ask you a few questions? I am looking for an investment property and need to do a deal today. I'm looking for either price or terms. I can act quickly for the right deal." Prospect: "Is this home for you?" Ralph: "No, it's for my company. We structure lease purchase transactions with landlords and sellers like yourself. We can do the deal with you, joint venture, or even consult with you. We have buyers and investors right now if you are flexible and ready to do a deal." Prospect: "You sure are a fast talker." Ralph: "Yes, ma'am, because I am working on several deals at the same time, and time is money. We are looking at several homes in your zip code, and we need to do something today. If this is uncomfortable for you, I understand, and I can get off the phone." Prospect: "Well, I need $65,000 for my condo." Ralph: Let's assume that is a fair price. Suppose I sent you a contract today for your full asking price, but I wanted a 24-month lease with an option to buy. I would give you the $500 a month rent, but I would need a 50% rent credit. Could we do business today? Ralph bit his lip and remained quiet. Prospect, could I think about it? Ralph, no, ma'am. You can just say no, but I will remove my offer from the table and not make it again. Didn't you say the home was vacant for the last 3 months? That means you have already lost $1,500, and that will be $2,000 by New Year's. Prospect, you have a point there. How do I know I can trust you? Ralph, suppose I gave you the referrals and references that met with your expectations. What would happen next? Prospect, I think we would have a deal. Ralph, you think or no, ma'am? Prospect, okay, I know. Ralph, thank you, ma'am. My associate will be at the condo at 1 p.m. with the contract and everything you need. You'll be receiving your rent beginning next month. You'll be paid on time, and all maintenance under $500 will be our responsibility. Are we good? Prospect, yes, and thank you. Ralph knew that he could rent out that place really fast because while the price was high, the rent, which was the prospect's mortgage payment, was very low for that area. In addition, the rent credit accumulated to $6,000 off the price. He would have Bubba get the paperwork together and have Simone begin calling the mortgage lenders who had clients, potential tenant buyers, who needed a little seasoning time in order to do the deal. He knew this was a small deal, and after paying out commissions, he would net at best $2,500. But it was a beginning. Matter of fact, he was able to set up 3 appointments today for Bubba to check out while he made more calls. He worked like mad from early morning until late at night, making call after call, submitting contracts and offers, negotiating any deal where he could generate an upfront profit. He even slept on the couch in the office lobby so he could get an early start the next day. Simone finally made him go home to shower and put on some fresh clothes. This went on for 5 days. He did a sandwich deal, a hybrid, a few assignments on a mobile home, a condo, and a few cottages out in the country. They were all what he called little or small deals, but they bought in cash flows and fast turnover. This was what he needed for now. He had enough money by the end of the week to pay the landlord and keep the lights on. He even gave some back to his employees, but he was still far away from his goal. He didn't forget that he needed money to stop the impending foreclosure on his home. There was another bright moment, however. He did one deal that gave him a note for $15,000, but he would have to wait 5 years to get paid. It did yield 8% interest, and it was secured. Ralph figured he had nothing to lose. Notes came in handy sometimes. Then he received a call from an investor friend, Arnie. Hey, Ralph, I have a deal that I just can't do. It's out of my league, and it's a winner. Are you in the game again? You bet, Arn. Tell me what you have. Arn explained. It's an apartment building, and the owner wants out fast. Something about an ex-wife wanting more than her original settlement. He is ready to move to Tahiti if he can flip it soon. Get this, the place is almost always 100% occupied because it's 1 mile away from the university. What makes this deal so special, Arn? Excitingly, Arn went on. It's worth $5 million, but he's willing to take less for the right deal. This is your basic cash is king deal. Do you happen to have a couple of mil on your debit card or know anyone who does? Maybe, Arn, just maybe. Give me the location and the owner's name, and I'll cut you in for 5% of anything I make. Make it 10%, and you got a deal, Arn countered. I will give you 7.5 of the net-net, and that's it, Ralph said firmly. Okay, you got yourself a deal. The owner's name is Mark Johnson, and here is his number. Don't forget me if you do the deal. Not to worry, old friend. You can count on me, Ralph assured him. Ralph thought that maybe this was the opportunity he was looking for. All he had to do was find a way to get this deal locked up fast and then start working his investor list. He had Simone set up an appointment with the owner while getting Bubba to do some due diligence on the property. The owner was a nice old guy who ran a smart, clean building. He was prepared to keep the building and let the management company send him a nice check every month. That was until he received a letter from his ex-wife's lawyer. He thought that she was a foregone and forgotten conclusion since he settled with her 6 years ago. He was pretty smart about it, too, since he had his cousin, the paralegal, draw up a marriage prenuptial contract. She got the house they were living in and $20,000 to go away. He thought that was fair, considering that she was a little too close to her Zumba teacher, if you know what I mean. He was always amazed at his naivete. I mean, who goes to a dance class 5 days a week? Mark took the matter to his real attorney and, to his dismay, discovered that his prenuptial agreement was, in his opinion, null and void because it wasn't notarized and some of the forms were wrong and from another state. His attorney told him that his ex might be entitled to as much as 50% of the building plus interest since they lived in a community property state. He also informed him that they may have a court date as soon as February. She would probably be able to file a lease pendants, a lien, on the apartment building after New Year's. He decided there was no way he was going to let this happen. She wouldn't get a cent if he had anything to do with it. He knew in a good market, at least, the last time he checked it, the property was worth $4.5 to $5 million. After all, he and his other cousin, the appraiser, checked the value about 9 months ago. Ralph met with the owner, and the negotiations began. "Sir, I understand that you need to sell your building and that you are willing to discount it for a quick turn deal. What is your best price?" "I want at least $3.5 million in cash deposited into my bank account by Christmas Eve," was his reply. That was less than a week away. Ralph thought to himself, "Seriously, what's your best price to sell it quickly?" he asked the owner. "I can be flexible," was his matter-of-fact reply. "What can you put down on the table?" Ralph inquired. "I have some investors who would be interested in such a deal if I can bring them a contract." "Money talks, son. I have other people who I'm also talking to. For $2.5 million, I will give you $5,000 in cash today," all the money Ralph had left with him from his small deals, "and a note for $20,000. If I can't do the deal before Christmas, then you get to keep it all and still resell the property. You win either way." The apartment owner thought to himself that he really had no prospective buyers, and the $25,000 might come in handy. He figured from the looks of Ralph, he would never be able to raise that kind of money. He had nothing to lose. "You got a deal, son," and they shook on it. Ralph arranged for a paralegal who was also a notary to stop by with the agreement, which he had prepared in advance. His attorney also checked it out and determined it was a solid contract. Now the game would really begin. Ralph and Bubba immediately prepared a complete prospectus on the apartment building. It contained all the necessary documents, pictures, rent analysis. The place was a gold mine. All he had to do was find the right buyer with cash. Everyone was on board, making phone calls and setting up appointments for Ralph with every wealthy investor in town. Basically, they told the investors they had a contract on an income-producing property in a great location for 50 cents on the dollar. The answers they received were all the same. "Too little time. Call me after the new year." Many were out of town starting their Christmas holiday early. One of the best investors, who he had done many deals with previously, was C.W. Ruby. C.W., as his friends called him, was a straightforward, shoot-from-the-hip, no BS investor from Texas. The only problem was that his secretary told Ralph that C.W. was out of town already on a ski holiday. Ralph knew that this was the man to see. The deal was too good to pass up for any investor he could meet face to face. He just needed to find the right one who had the cash to close quickly. Ralph decided that he was in for a penny and in for a pound. He checked the airport and all the flights were either full or delayed due to storms. So he got in his car and began the 1,400-mile drive to Colorado Mountains. He called Emily and told her he wouldn't be home for dinner. He instructed Bubba and Simone to find out where CW was staying and make sure he had an appointment with him when he got into town. It took Ralph 24 hours driving in bad weather to get to Winter Park, Colorado, the highest unincorporated city in the United States, 12,060 feet above sea level. He arrived in the town just about 8 a.m. He was exhausted when he pulled into the Olympia Lodge located in the middle of town. He called Bubba, who told Ralph that he had gotten lucky and finally got hold of CW. Bubba arranged for a breakfast meeting that day at 10 a.m. "Ralph, this guy was a tough sell," Bubba began. "He really didn't want to meet with you until I told him you were driving all night to show him the deal of the year." Ralph barely had time to shower, shave, and put on some clean clothes before he drove into the parking lot of the Rise and Shine Cafe for his breakfast meeting. He walked into the old saloon and saw CW in a corner booth. "Hope you don't mind, Ralph. I took the liberty of ordering some food. Figured you'd be a little hungry after your drive." CW stood and shook Ralph's hand. Was CW kidding? Ralph was starving after eating nothing but bad truck stop coffee and donuts. Just as Ralph sat down, two of the house specialties, gigantic Mexican breakfast burritos, were placed on the table. They were the size of a football. Basically, they were a couple of flour tortillas with a slab of chorizo sausage, fresh eggs and potatoes smothered in cheese and warm picante sauce. There was a fresh press of coffee on the table, which Ralph finished. The press was replaced by an efficient ski-bum waiter. "Okay, Ralph, you must have come here for a purpose. Let me hear what you got." "First thing, CW, thank you for letting me impose on your time and interrupt your holiday with your family." "Don't mention it, Ralph. You probably did me a favor getting me out of the house with all the kids and in-laws. I couldn't get any work done, but I have to get back soon." "Okay, I'll get right to the point. Have you had a chance to look at the prospectus that my secretary sent you?" "Yeah, I glanced at it." "If memory serves me correctly, you like properties that pencil out and show an immediate equity position. In addition, you also want one that has a history of full occupancy and which cash flows to itself to profitability. The deal has that and more," Ralph told him. "Bottom line, CW, it's a no-brainer. It has a street value of $5.2 million, and I have a contract for $2.5 million. You will have an instant profit of $2.7 million less my assignment fee. The occupancy rate is 80%, but we can fill the remaining apartments in the next 30 days, and there hasn't been a rent adjustment in over 5 years. I need $2.5 million wired to the escrow company bank account before midnight tomorrow. No, in fact, I need it sent today, to give the attorney time to draft the paperwork." "Hold on a minute, Ralph. My dad used to say that any deal is too good to be true usually is. No offense, but I'm a businessman first. Why should I rush into a deal that I may be able to pick up once your option expires after the holiday?" "CW, you're too smart to let a deal like this pass. The owner gave me this deal because he knew I am broke and he wanted an easy $25K for me. He knows that he can eventually sell this building for $3.5 to $4 million for a quick sale for cash after the new year. He has some past legal issues with his ex-wife and a prenuptial agreement. The owner needs to move fast, but his greed got the better of him and he gambled that I would fail. Why don't we prove him wrong, CW? Frankly, I am broke. I gambled that I would find a smart entrepreneur like yourself who could recognize a great deal that will make him even richer. Are you ready to do this deal today, or should I get out of here and find someone else?" "I like the way you talk, Ralph. You get to the point without the garbage that I usually hear from agents and investor types. Can you do other deals for me like this going into New Year, Ralph?" Ralph took a breath. This was the moment he waited for. He was prepared with the first close. "Suppose I said yes, CW. What happens next?" "I guess we move forward." "You guess or you know, CW." Ralph stood up and assertively held out his hand to consummate the deal. Okay, I know." What? Ralph feigned a hearing deficit. "I said you have a deal. What are you, deaf?" he bellowed. They both smiled and Ralph breathed an enormous sigh of relief. Ralph still had one more card up his sleeve and he had to play it well. He bit his time and waited for the second moment. CW gave instructions to Ralph. "You call my attorney in New York here. Here's his number." And as he handed over a business card, "I will authorize the wire transfer today. I'll give you a limited power of attorney to close the deal before tomorrow at 12 noon. We don't have much time, but I've had deals like this before. You just have to kick a little Texas butt. You take my private jet. It's parked over in the Tabernash International Jetway. It's all fueled and can be out of here and get you back to Seattle before lunchtime." With that, he sent a text to his pilot over at the hotel to prep the plane. "Oh, yes, you tell that apartment owner that if he plays any games or delays, I will tie up that building for the next 5 years, and his ex-wife will be the only one who gets any money." There was only one thing left for us to discuss. "You seem to be a pretty smart guy, but we haven't discussed how you make any money here. I don't trust partners who don't have an angle, a percentage in the deal. Why would you do all this without negotiating a commission for me?" CW was perplexed. Ralph jumped in. "Because you are going to gladly give me $250,000 tomorrow as a commission and 10% ownership of our new apartment building." "Why should I do that? We already have a deal. We shook paws on it." "No offense, Ralph, but you can't negotiate a deal after the horse has left the barn. Why in blazes should I give you anything?" This was the second close moment that Ralph had planned. "CW, you are a smart man, too. and you like to make money, you will give me what I ask because A, it's fair and reasonable, and you stand to make over $2 million on this deal alone upfront and $150,000 a year net on the rents. B, you and I are going to form an S-Corp, and I am going to do many more deals like this. I, in return, will get 50% of the stock. I will take no salary until we become profitable. At that time, we will negotiate something. You can decline my offer, but wouldn't you rather have someone who makes you more money with the lease purchase deals that I create and find rather than send them to other investors? Or maybe I should keep all the deals for myself. What should I do, CW? Now hold your horses, son. I only have one question. Will you take 49% of the stock? Nope. We are equal partners. Your money and my knowledge of lease purchasing and gut selling and marketing. Ralph looked at him in the aisles. Deal or no deal? Okay, deal. But one more question. How'd you learn all this stuff? You're the best darn salesman and deal maker I ever met. Ralph smiled as he answered. It's a long ghost story. He looked up into the Colorado snow-capped mountains and saw Max smiling from above. Epilogue. And Ralph was as good as his word. Emily and the kids had the best Christmas ever. He stopped the foreclosure on his home and paid off all his bills. He gave Bubba and Simone a raise with all their back pay and an enormous holiday bonus, not to mention stock in the new business with CW. Ralph had changed the destiny of all their lives for the better. Oh, yes. He named the new company DYJLAHE Inc. Don't you just love a happy ending? The end. This is Claude Diamond. Hope you enjoyed the Lease Purchase Christmas Carol. If you'd like the book, the textbook, the audio and video, the mind maps, and a consultation, go to the link below on my webpage, clauddiamond.com. And to everyone, have a Merry Christmas, a Happy Hanukkah, a wonderful Kwanzaa, and stay safe and healthy. Bye-bye.